I should be... Yeah, hi.
There you are. Hey, how are you?
There he is.
How you doing?
Doing good, good. Just been a bit crazy this whole, you know, the last couple of days because, you know, we were getting up for Mirzapur to release. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's been a hell of a week.
How has the pandemic been treating you?
You know, I mean, I guess everybody's just, it's gone to shits, right? The world has gone to shits.
Right.
So,
Have y'all started back up any filming at all or no?
Yeah, we have. I think work has begun in many parts, but we're just being cautious because clearly, like, India's topping the charts.
Right.
We're not far behind.
Yeah. We're up there with you guys, man.
Are you guys doing, like, here in the States where shows are back in production, they're getting really strict with, like, doing COVID testing every day and things of that nature. You guys have implementation for stuff like that?
Yeah, I mean, not every day, but I think, like, I had to do one twice before I started shoot.
Sure.
But again, I don't even understand it. Like, I don't get it. You get a COVID test, and the very next second, you could just catch it from the next freaking...
Literally.
Literally.
Yeah.
So, it's just, like, one big little bubble. Like, I don't even know what the hell it is. So, we're just playing along, and that's what's going to become, like, rules and protocol, I suppose. So,
yeah. Well, I want to thank you for chatting with us. We big admirers. We just watched Mazipur probably about, I think it was almost a month ago, which is way later than most people watched it. So we're very excited for season two to come out, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But we wanted to talk about you as an actor and a performer first. So how did you first get into acting?
I was a ball player. I was playing hockey back in school, and I mean, I literally broke my arm, and I was in this boarding school, and you know, you gotta keep doing something or the other. And I remember my friend telling me like, you know, there's this troupe that's come to school, they're doing Shakespeare, and your English isn't bad. Why don't you go try, you know, and don't get depressed and shit and go there and do something, you know, because I had plans, man. I played serious ball and I went and I thought, and I think it worked out.
Yeah, I would say so.
So ever since then I came to Bombay, and you know, Bombay was, you know, the Indian cinema, and you know, I started with cameos, and then around the same time I did a cameo in like Fast and Furious, which is one very random thing I did, and so it was like this parallel sort of beginning of cinema, I suppose. Mm. Yeah.
Now,
a
little bit of stage before that. Really want to ask you a question, because when I did not realize you were Abdul in Victoria.
Which
is the highest level compliment I could give to you, because you are what I would describe as a shapeshifter, as an actor, that you can transform yourself. Because I loved Victoria and Abdul when it came out.
Thank you.
It was one of my favorite films of the year. I loved everything about it. Your character in this series is so different that you were literally unrecognizable. And I just wanted to know, is this something that has come naturally to you? Have you had extensive training? What's your story as far as your development as an actor?
I feel like a cheat sometimes. That's what it is. I read a lot. I never got a chance to study acting, actually. So I did it on stage. I read a lot of books because I was a science student. I was... I did economics and my God, I did my master's and all that. So studies was happening on one side, but I think it's been learning on the job and sort of being aware of just the human condition, right? Also, I mean, there's been a huge influence of like Western cinema in my life, because we were religious about following the award season since we were kids, and you know, and back then, like, the movies never released in India. So I mean, we would pirate that shit and just literally get the movies somehow, you know. And it's so weird because I remember getting those DVD screeners, you know, from Torrens, and now I'm sitting, I'm a voting member, and I get those freaking DVD screeners. I'm thinking, yeah. My God, like, this is bad. but it's, I mean, yeah, you know, I wish I did. And mm-hmm. sometimes I feel like I have to play catch up when it comes to grammar of cinema, when it comes to, I mean, just evolving, I suppose, as an actor, as a person. But it has happened, I think, as I've moved along. Like, I thought Abdul could have been, you know, a notch up. But then that's me thinking now. At the time, that's the best I knew. Part 2 is actually a totally different take on... I mean, it's a major shift in this character, so I don't know. I don't, you know, it's pretty much a gamble, actually.
Yeah.
But sometimes it's calculated, and I like to think, you know, the most spontaneous things come out when they're well choreographed.
Yeah.
As opposed to just going with the flow.
On the subject of Hollywood and Indian cinema, was that always a conscious effort that you wanted to have a career in both? Because there's very few that I can think of prominent Indian actors that have done it as successfully as you have already done it. I'm thinking Irfan, Taboo, and very few others that have been able to actually have successful careers in both. Was that always a conscious effort that you wanted to do?
It wasn't always a conscious effort. I think the first one was, it happened, you know,
yeah.
And Fast and Furious was just, they weren't even casting in India. And I remember I tested and it worked out because, you know, we were, I don't know, we're just playing around with voices and just having fun with it. And it was a fun set. But I think it made me realize that there is access, you know, there is access to world cinema, and not just American, but even European,
yep.
or whatever. And I want to be able to be open to that. I think stories, I mean, at the end of the day, emotions connect us all across, right? It's the same 9 emotions that we're dealing with all across the planet. And, you know, it's just the geography that sort of keeps, and of course, our cultures and everything. So yeah, hell yeah. You know, I think Indian cinema is great. It's happening, it's evolving, but I'm not planning to leave home. But at the same time, you know, I've
yeah.
always been interested because, you know, I think sometimes the quality benchmarks are definitely higher on the other side, right? Like we've grown up watching French cinema and Polish and American, great, some Hollywood classics and stuff. And I think, yeah, there's great work happening on both sides.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that I would assume then that that's your mindset moving forward, is just to be open to all of it, and that you would love to work
yeah.
wherever there's just the opportunity to do good work.
Yeah, I think that's the idea, to be able to just evolve as much as we can, right? I mean, as people, that is the idea, to be able to reinvent yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I sometimes did feel like I was working in India and there were projects I was working on. I used to feel really stale. And you know, when somebody's not pushing you out of your limits and sort of using you for maybe what you can bring to the table. I mean, like I worked with Freers on Victorian Abdul, and what really amazed me is, and I mean, every actor goes on set and he has a play, right? When you know your scene, you have a certain thing in mind.
Yeah.
And then there's the director who comes in and just sort of throws you off, you know, and you improvise and you work within those boundaries, you know, that little skeleton that he gives you.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun because you discover something new and you work with it. And I thought, that's such a, that's magic. That's like two people creating something out of, it wasn't thought of, right?
Yep.
He thought of it. He thought
yes.
of something, and I thought of something. And then we bring in, and I merge that with his little, you know, anyway, yeah, cost of sounding pseudo.
Yeah, no, that's right. That is a really great point, and it leads me to a question in regard to that, because improvisation, Corbin and I talk about that all the time. It's just, it's so important for an actor to be able to freely improvise, because oftentimes that's where the magic, real moments take place. And,
yeah.
you know, having worked with Dame Judi Dench and Frears, and yeah. have you found, have the... maybe a hard question for you to answer, but has the larger influence as far as you're expanding as an actor, understanding improv, learning on set, has that come from the actors you've worked with, more the directors who shaped you, or is it kind of a mix of both?
I think it's been a bit of both, but mostly I think the directors I've worked with, because also it's like there's a director in India called Tigmanshu Dhulia, and there's a director, and of course I recently worked with Kenneth Branagh on Death on the Nile, and I mean he's an actor, and so he's so giving, and he's always open to changes, and you know what an actor is bringing to the set, and those are moments when you get to lift off the page, right? Because I've worked with people who are very sacrosanct, very religious about the page and about the text, and that's fine, each to his. But I thought in those moments I was pushed to sort of make sense of the world around me and actually and deliver. So it was fun. So that improvisation was it worked out. I mean, thank God it did.
Yeah. But yeah. So you've actually worked with quite a few legends of Indian cinema and Hollywood cinema, like absolute legends. Obviously, Dame Judi Dench, Kenneth
Branagh,
Tripathi. Like, who was probably the most intimidating person that you had to act alongside with?
Oh,
in terms of having to act with them.
Wow, I can't think of. I don't know. I just. I get really excited when there's a big actor around me because they make my freaking job easy.
Yeah. Oh, right.
So I'm sorry. I'm like, I sound selfish, but it's a selfish thing. Like I
it's true.
They make me look good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So when there's, you know, when there's Annette Bening and right next to me, or Russell Brand or whatever, I mean, you know, the others, it was nice. It was like, okay, you know, I can do my thing, and they're just, they're doing theirs, and they're doing a pretty good job. I don't know. Maybe Aamir Khan once. I mean, that was my first film, and I thought, I was a bit nervous, and he broke the ice, and he sort of guided me through it, you know?
Yeah.
Nervous? I don't know. Maybe, I guess Vin Diesel, for some reason, because he just walks in like a freaking, you know, he's like this boss man on set, to sort of, you know, like, hey, man, you know, and you're thinking like, is he going to beat the shit out of me right now, or is he just going to take me to the corner, and he says, you know, I want to make you meet somebody, buddy, and, you know, and
then funny. He
takes me to the writer or whatever, and sort of we have this little chat. No, but these guys, it's just for that little moment, you know, I had a bit of a okay, you know.
How did you become, you know, because it's really, it's quite impressive, astonishing, whatever other adjectives you want to use, that you were able to come basically, especially from a Western audience, out of nowhere per se, to star alongside Dame Judi Dench and Victoria and Abdul. How did you become involved with Victoria and Abdul?
Again, it was weirdly, they were casting in India for Abdul, and it was just an experiment, apparently, that because they probably would have gone with somebody based out of there, from London, but they tried to test people in India, and I wasn't even called for it. I was literally sitting with an agent, and she said, there's this film happening, and at the time I think they were looking at Meryl Streep and Dame, both of them. Because Frears had just worked with Meryl Streep on Jenkins. Florence.
Yeah, Ross, Florence.
Yeah, Jenkins, yeah.
So I literally I think I squeezed myself into that casting. I called the casting director. I said, listen, I'll shoot it on my phone. I'll send it to you. I mean, what's the harm? Because it was that day, it was the last day, 5 p.m. I still remember. And I said, I'll just do one scene and there's nothing to lose, right? You just send it off. And she said, okay, fine, you know, whatever. And then 25, I think another 20, 25 days later, I got a call. They wanted to meet me, I think. Yeah, they flew down, and Frears, which was again really scary, because I remember meeting Frears for the first time. This is Stephen Frears. I walk into the hotel room. Beben Kidron, a producer, she's sitting there, very sweet. Stephen Frears sprawled across the couch, because he has a freaking Deli Belly. And I love him, man. He's a sweetheart, but he's a grumpy old sweetheart, right?
Yeah.
Like, he's that grumpy guy who goes, you know, speak, write, scene, read, you know, and this is my first time in front of a legend, and I think that's where you can say, like, I got really scared. Like, that was the first time I got intimidated by somebody, and
yeah,
but then it worked out, so I was happy for that, you know?
Yes, it did. And now you have a film. I don't know if it's still coming out in December or not, but Death on the Nile, right?
Yes.
What can we expect from that? I mean, that has what? Armie Hammer, Gal Gadot, Kenneth.
Oh, yeah.
What can we expect from that film?
Oh, that's going to be a fun one. That's I'm really excited because, God, it's such a diverse cast, I mean, to begin with. And I'm really grateful that it's been also a result of, like, blind casting, because my part was played by George Kennedy, you know, who was back in the day in the first movie, the 1971 film with Bette Davis and Maggie Smith and everybody. But so I remember that time the character was Uncle Andrew, and now it's Cousin Andrew. So Gal plays Linny, and both of our characters are cousins, and he's British, he's not Indian, so it's there's no reference for of where they belong and from where they come from, you know. There's just no mention of that. We're just characters in an Agatha Christie movie, and we're suspects, and, you know.
Do you know if it's still supposed to come out in December?
Yeah. I mean, that's the last news we heard. Okay. It was supposed to come out the same day as Mirzapur, actually, October 23rd. Yeah. So I think, but it's a good thing that they pushed it. Because, I mean, we've shot it on film, and this is 65 Panavision. This is like serious film cameras. Wow. So yeah, you don't want to, I don't want to miss that. Yeah, please.
Yeah. Put it on a big screen. Absolutely.
Yeah. I miss it. I miss that. Yeah, we need that.
I do too. Well, speaking of Mirzapur, first of all, you were one of the first characters. We were impressed with the fact that initially we see your character, we see Gudu, and we're thinking, okay, this is just going to be some brainless beefcake guy, right? Initially. And yeah. One of the first things that impressed us was, and this is really a genuine compliment, is the fact that you played this character that at first does come across as just a total... He's focused on his body. He doesn't seem to be very smart. That's not an easy thing to do and make it believable.
Yeah.
It can be really cliche. And you were one of the first things that impressed us with the show, was that believability. So I just, how did you become involved with the series? And then I'd love to know about the physical transformation.
Yeah.
I mean, it was, the director came to me, and he, you know, they offered me, I mean, they tested me first, and I, in fact, they offered me the villain, the other part.
Manu?
After, Munna, yeah.
Munna? Okay.
And but they tested me for Gudu, so it was weird, and I was so sold on that, because I thought there was something undone, something undiscovered about this boy, and that really excited me, you know, the unpredictability about this character. The fact that it will require a team for this thing to come together. I mean, I'm talking costumes, I'm talking direction, I'm talking the other actors, and of course the physicality, the look. So I designed that look. I literally sat with my director and I said, you know, this, like, he shouldn't have hair, and this is how I see him. And the thing was, at the time, I don't think anybody... See, also the thing is, in India, things work. It's like you're cast for what you are your last Friday, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's your image that is cast in the next movie, and so so it was a nice little surprise when somebody took a chance on me. There were like two people gunning for me in the production house, thinking, we think this guy might be able to pull it off, because I'd never done parts like that, and I've always played like very, you know, sort of.
Nope. Well, there you are. Okay. Sorry about that. All right. I think we're good.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Oh, he's gone.
He's gone.
The fuck? Okay, yeah. All right,
we're good.
Yeah, so the fact that they took a shot with you and let you do something outside of what your last role was.
Yeah, I think that was something really commendable, and they gave me a chance to do that. But I like I said, you know, I took about 6 months to get ready for it. Mm-hmm. 6 to 7 months actually, of course, you know, and 2 months on during shoot, I carried on like working out because the mm-hmm. physical transformation was a lot. I'd never done something like that, you know, mm-hmm. just built like muscle mass. So that was really hard, especially because I also wasn't on steroids or anything like that. So that was just it was just double the work. So I remember, I mean, I got that size and we were working on like compound muscles, and it was pretty hard. I mean, the training was hard, and I think eventually we pulled something, some version of it.
Yeah. How hard was that to maintain? I mean, I understand getting in shape prior to filming. Freaking hard was that to maintain while you were filming?
It's crazy. I mean, I was like a bit cranky on sets because we were shooting like 12 hours, 12, 14 hours sometimes. And we were right like in the interiors of India. Like, this is where Mirzapur is. And it was hot. And then you're working out for two hours a day. So I was on a bit of a less sleep. And but yeah, I mean, you know, I think I suppose it worked out eventually.
A lot of breast milk to drink a lot of.
Can you imagine that's true? That actually is. The people do that, right?
Yeah.
I remember there was somebody in I saw this documentary. Somebody in the States. This woman. She packs like some freaking, like thousands of packets of her breast milk, and like that's her life. Like that's how
she sells it. Living. Oh wow.
She sells it online. Like she sells it. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Does it work?
I never tried that. I don't
know. I'm sure there's other sources of protein that work out just fine.
So I've seen in the promos that you now have a luscious beard in season 2. So what can we expect? Obviously, if you haven't seen Mazipur, people watching, obviously go watch season 1.
Go watch.
There might be spoilers here. So. What can we expect from your character and also Mazipur season 2?
Well, season 2 is I mean, the stakes are high, emotions are high. You know, it's also a very different choice as an actor, like I've taken, because again, it's human, right?
Yeah.
Your half your family is wiped out in front of your eyes. What do you do? Right? You can go crazy, you can walk out, you go for the revenge, you go for whatever. So yeah, I thought it was a choice welcomed by my filmmakers, by my director, by my writer, and I kind of stuck with it. And it's a little mature, Gudu. I think I always saw him as somebody who was very lazy, and he was not just dumb, because his father was a lawyer, his brother was smart, you know, his sister is smart. His mother is like this crazy, weird, genius sort of person. I mean, I just felt like the apple cannot fall far from the tree, and he was not interested in all this stuff. He was always interested in, like, you know, the cool stuff and, you know, bodybuilding or you know, aping like favorite movie stars. I mean, that's what these guys do in small cities, you know. But now it's push comes to shove and shit hits the fan. And but it's a subtle change, I suppose, you know, through season 2, and you see him sort of finding his own.
So he becomes the brain and the brawn almost.
I mean, he has to. I don't know what happens eventually. I shouldn't be giving out spoilers. but you know, I think it was. I mean, shooting it was a bit lonely because Vikrant was a great sort of, you know, thing to go with. Like, he was, because we would sort of have this nice little duet. But this time Shweta has come on. You know, she's playing Golu. Mm-hmm. and she turns into this Lara Crofty image, you know, and this character. So you see her sort of transforming into that. But so yeah, it's an interesting theme. I mean, we'll see what happens. Yeah.
Do you have a preference? We've asked this question to every actor and even directors we've talked to, and we've pretty much seen a uniform answer, and it doesn't surprise us being actor ourselves. Do you have a preference as to portraying roles that are film, theater, or being on a series like the one you're on right now?
I mean, you know, we love the celluloid. I mean, who doesn't, right? You gotta love it. It's a 70mm. It's big. yeah. But again, you know, theater is different. Theater is like, it feels like home. And I think one day I will go back to it. I don't find the time anymore and, sure. and the commitment for it. And the money.
Yeah.
No, I mean, it's sad actually, because Indian theater is really, really good, but there's just no money here. Like we still haven't cracked that. What London's done with national, Broadway's done for America or so many other venues, New York pretty much, but yeah, so that leaves me with film and series. I think series, of course, I mean, depends if they're really good scripts, because it's a lot of commitment. I mean, shooting Mirzapur is like shooting three movies back to back, you know,
and yeah. Right.
And after a point, you're like, dude, I'm done. I'm like, just get it done with, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of, So I didn't really answer that question. I just give you all options. Movies for me, if you ask me. Yeah.
Okay. Who has influenced you as an actor in terms of who you've drawn the most inspiration from? In Hollywood, world cinema, Indian cinema, who's like the actor that you've looked up to the most, or multiple of them?
I mean definitely multiple, but I think in India I was a big fan of Dilip Kumar. Mm-hmm. You know, he was a great actor, one of the greats. I've been heavily influenced by Brando. I think of course so many people adore his style. Peter Sellers, Marlon Brando.
Oh.
These are, yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, this is, and there's something, so there's a surprise that's almost like about to spring out in their performances, and that sort of keeps you, and I love that. I love their choices as actors, and I've always wondered where that method comes from, or whatever it is. And I think like I think Joaquin Phoenix has mm-hmm. that, like he's so measured. He's crazy. I mean, I don't know what it is, but it's I feel like after a point you don't rely on instinct, you know. It's almost like you're stepping out of your body and you're observing your face, and it's just one canvas that's just in your you know, you have a grip on it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's beautiful to be able to get there. I'm still learning, and I look up to these people. I think they're pretty good.
Yeah.
And to be able to do that, I think you need to understand, you need to sort of empathize with the human condition, right? Like with what's, like I see a lot of my colleagues, and they're just closed up, and they're away from what's happening in the world, but you can't be, right? Like you got to be in sync with what the fuck is happening everywhere.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you're just in the name of art, we're basically then just doing jobs, and mm-hmm. I only say this because there's so much shit happening in our country, and you know, I guess everywhere, right? And it's just one of those phases where it's just like, you know, the wave of I suppose, I don't know, authoritarianism and whatever you mm-hmm. call it.
Yeah. No, and I agree. I think the two most important attributes for any actor are the capacity to be deeply empathetic to the human condition, and also have a vivid imagination. If you've got those two, if you have a vivid imagination and deep empathy, you've pretty much got everything you need. You just need to access it and use that. Two-part question. What's your favorite thing about being an actor? What's your least favorite thing about being an actor?
Oh my God. Okay. The favorite thing about being an actor is, I think there's a little bit of a power game there, right? Like you're standing there, And for that little moment, you know you have them by the balls. You have them. You control the twitches on their faces. For that 1 hour, I have you. I have your, right. your emotions. I have your tension, hopefully. And the weakness is, I suppose, we're constantly just volatile and vulnerable people, because we're subjected to rejection all the time. We're supposed to get used to it. And that one rejection is, I suppose, equal to somebody in another job losing that job, that one job that you worked for. And we face that on a daily basis, because, you know, out of 10, you know, I mean, like, I test for parts, or I've had a meeting that's gone, you know, bad, and it doesn't work out, and you feel the same, but you got to get up and then go back and back and back and keep at it. So that sucks.
What's one thing you would like to change about Indian cinema?
Actually, about Hindi cinema is something I would say, we need to get out of that bubble. And I think we are slowly. This bubble of just Bollywood, and that the Indian cinema is just Bollywood, and that's not.
No.
Because I think right. down south, Malayalam cinema, yes. Tamil cinema, they're like, they're on my list. Like, I'm starting to learn Malayalam now because I want to work with them. I think they're doing, those are the movies that should be going for the Oscars from India, not, I mean, I have as much respect for our Hindi cinema, but, and they're making some good stuff, but hey man, it's just really good. Have you seen did you guys watch Super Deluxe?
Yes, we did.
Oh yeah.
The one we really loved from was Kumbhalaji Nights from Malayalam.
Brilliant.
Anything with anything with Fahad Fasil in it is incredible. Yeah.
Go
ahead.
No, I think Fahad is brilliant. I think he's making great choices as an actor and a producer, and it's really good.
Have you seen Hellarau? Hellarau?
What is that?
Hellarau.
Gujarati.
Oh, I haven't.
It's absolutely beautiful. Brilliant.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm. Gujarati, huh? I'll check it out.
Gujarati.
Yeah. Beautiful film.
But we totally agree. Obviously, we've seen over 130 now, I think, somewhere around that number in the year and a half or so that we've been doing Indian content, and from all different regions. And we've seen brilliant films from, obviously, Hindi cinema. The fact that sometimes certain stuff gets sent to the Oscars that we think could have beaten Parasite style of films don't get sent. Yeah. We agree with your frustration.
I think we're slowly evolving, and I feel that is something that I just hope we can bridge that, because, and I think it's going to happen on its own, because the canvas just got bigger, and now we're a pause button away from rejection. You know, if somebody doesn't like, you know, you hit pause and I'm on to the next French American show that I want to watch on Amazon or Netflix or whatever it is. And,
And I think we've seen a lot of our, you know, subscribers, our stupid babies, who've said, thank you so much for opening our eyes to Malayalam cinema and cinema from Assam and cinema from all, you know, Telugu and Tamil, because they even in their own country haven't opened themselves up to it. And it's starting to happen. Corbin had mentioned, go ahead. No, yeah, please.
No, I'm just saying, I'm so glad you guys are doing this. Like, this is amazing, because, you know, as far as I know, the Academy has records of only Satyajit Ray and Ritvik Ghatak, the two Bengali directors.
Yeah,
like,
right.
That is all we have in the archives. Of course, maybe now, you know, but at the time, there was just all those years, there was nothing, you know, with the Academy. And of course, now we have a database and everything, but that's just huge. There's so much cinema. Like,
so much.
Court was another Marathi film. If you
haven't seen that one. That one's probably our next Marathi film.
Oh, you must. So that's Chaitanya Tamahe, who's Tamahe, right? He just entered the Venice Film Festival with his second film.
We saw the trailer for that.
The Disciple.
We saw that trailer.
On the American Indian relationship, do you? Because for a long time, Because a thing I love to complain about in Indian cinema is the white actors are just terrible. Any white foreign actor is just awful. But that's been the same comparison with a lot of Indians with Hollywood cinema, is that a lot of the Indian actors are stereotyped. Do you see that that is changing now? Since you're in more in Hollywood films, do you see it more like there's more open roles for just Indians in general and people of color?
Yeah, I think we're done with, you know, I think all we knew at the time was how Russell Peters imitated Indians, right? Like, I mean, that was just one caricature that became what Indian was. And then that's how, and I suppose there's also that generation of NRIs, you know, the non-resident Indians who live abroad, who live in America. So that concept of Indian was a bit off.
Yeah.
So I think that's happening now. Like, I remember on Victoria and Abdullah, I was pretty adamant on certain pronunciations and certain, like, I mean, people sometimes would ask me why is it so normal? And I said, you guys ruled over us for 200 years. Obviously we know English. We, you know, I mean, we knew good English, and there is no accent. It's literally just proper Queen's English. It's just less twangs maybe and very clear. And,
Absolutely.
So yeah, I think that is definitely slowly changing. I think, you know, like you said, people like Irfan Khan, you know, and Om Puri, and these people stuck to their guns and did not sort of conform to that template. So, and I'm glad they did that. They left us a legacy, and I hope I can sort of, I don't know,
be part of it. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. We had mentioned, you know, Fahad Fasil and obviously Irfan and people who are the legends in the business. Who are some of the folk, and this is Indian cinema, American cinema, whatever you want, who are some of the people, actors, directors, that you're like, oh, I want to work with them so badly? Who are some of the top of your list you want to work with?
Oh, so many.
I'm sure it's a Raju long Hirani. List.
Yeah, it's a long list. I mean, Alan Sorkin, the Scorsese's. Mm. Of course, you have the regulars. Jean right. Genet. I mean, I could go on. There's, you know, Cleo Bernard. I don't know, so many, all kinds of directors. Catherine Bigelow. What else? Inarritu. I think he has a totally. God, he's doing some iconic stuff. He's really doing. Did you guys manage to see the virtual the VR stuff he did at the LA Museum? He created that. He got the Oscar for that entire project. He got the governor's Oscar, the honorary Oscars for that.
Oh yeah. He did. Yes.
I remember I was there and it was, my God, it was beautiful. It's like this little VR trip that you go into and you end up at the border, at the Mexican border. And how Mexicans are being treated, like you're, you know, it's you get that experience.
No, I didn't get to see that though.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. But anyway, yeah, a lot of directors, a lot of Indian directors, I think, coming up. Again, like I said, Chaitanya is one hell of a director, very young, and yet I think he's gonna make a lot of people proud. There's Zoya Akhtar. She's really good.
Yep.
And a lot of, I think, Tamil and Malayalam directors, you know, there's an endless list there. So,
Well, I want to thank you for chatting with us, man. I want to finish it off by just a little bit of a rapid fire questions here before we end it. So coffee or chai?
Oh, man, coffee. I'm coffee.
Good. Favorite alcoholic beverage?
Ooh. I'm beer.
What kind?
I mean, wheat.
Mm.
Is that too easy? I don't know.
No, it's good.
Alcohol is good. Favorite Hollywood film?
Favorite what? Hollywood?
Hollywood film.
Ooh.
Or a couple.
On the Waterfront. Last Tango. I'm naming all Brando films. It's just
The Godfather.
No, you're gonna pull me down there.
Streetcar Named Desire.
Favorite Indian film. Any region.
Mughal-e-Azam.
Oh, that. Oh, yeah. They're the classic, right?
Yeah, the classic.
Yeah, we haven't seen that one yet.
You should watch that for the screenplay and Mera Naam Joker.
Yeah. Brilliant film. I think we've seen a song from that film, Mera Naam Joker. Yeah. I think we've seen a song from that one. Favorite Hollywood director?
Actually, Iñárritu. I think he's,
He's Birdman. Fabulous. Birdman was incredible.
Incredible.
Favorite Indian director?
Kamal Swaroop.
Okay.
He's a very lesser known, but yeah, he's made something crazy a long time back. And yeah, I'm hoping to work with him, hopefully, if he comes out of hiding.
Favorite Hollywood actor or actress?
Joaquin Phoenix, Meryl Streep, Emily Blunt, I think. Yeah.
And favorite Indian actor and actress? Besides yourself, of course.
I like Tabu. I think she's fabulous. She's just she's a rock star. And guys, there's Irfan Bhai was Nawazuddin is really good. You know, Nawaz is very good.
He's
I like him.
Yeah, I do too. And your favorite book?
Whoa. Lust for Life.
Lust for Life?
Yeah, that's a story on Van Gogh, the painter. Yeah, it's a great book. You should read it. Yeah.
Look at that. So thank you so much for chatting with me, man. It's been a pleasure. We absolutely cannot wait for season two in what, five or so days to see your performance and everybody else that's coming out with that. So, and we're very much looking forward to you doing stuff in all regions and infiltrating the Hollywood with more amazing Indian actors. So once again, thank you for talking to us, Rick.
Yeah, we never fake anything at all. If we don't like something, we'll say it. We love your show. We love what you're doing with the character. And I'm reminded of what you said right at the very beginning of us talking to you when I asked you about your training and please, some of the greatest performances captured on film were done by children who had no training. They were just emotionally available and they were 100% believable. That's the level. You have a natural giftedness that's extremely rare, and we're rooting for you to do great things because you are, in our opinion, a tremendously gifted actor.
Oh man, you're really generous with your words.
I mean it. I genuinely mean it.
Thanks, man. I mean, thank you. It's really sweet of you guys. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So we wish you the best.
You have a great night. All right, man.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. Have a good one. Bye bye.
Take care.